Hello and good afternoon, friends. Welcome to the EduSet lecture. In this lecture of ours, we bring for you different topics, different subjects, and as far as now, we have been carrying a topic that is political theory, and through political theory, we are trying to learn about various aspects associated with this particular theory. And for this, today we have in our studio Dr. Satish Kumar, Head of Department, and he is the Head of Department of the Political Sciences Department in itself, Central University, Haryana. And today he is with us, and with him we are going to learn about what is comparative politics is. That is, we are going to learn about what is the introduction of the comparative politics, as well as how it is relevant in the present context. What are the major tools used and what are the themes under comparative politics? So first of all, I would like to introduce as well as welcome our guest, our lecturer, Dr. Satish Kumar.
Thank you.
Dr. Satish, you are welcomed in this EduSet lecture of ours. So we would like you to explain what is introduction to the comparative analysis, and we, if we talk about the present future, the present context, how it is related to that.
Thank you, Geetika. Good afternoon, everyone. As we all know, the comparative politics is an essential part of political theory, a political science. Over a period of time, this extension of political science has become more relevant. Why it has become more relevant? Because the politics, as we understand, it is a struggle for power. A conflict and conflict resolutions, the study of the institutions within the country. Comparative politics is an extension which is not limited to a particular country, but the different countries of the world. We compare the institutions, we compare the political systems, we compare the different aspects of political theory, and then we try to identify and learn and gain from each other. And that is how the comparative politics become today more relevant. We will discuss the different themes and layers and origins with the social networking and digital world. This theme has become more promising, more knowledgeable, more useful for the student of political science.
Yes, sir. So I would like you to explain how, if we talk about the present context, how comparative politics is emerging as an imminent or prominent tool when we talk about the political theory.
Geetika and my friends, if you try to trace the history of comparative politics, it begins with the political science as well. The father of political science, as we know, Aristotle, and his book, The Polity, which he has written almost 100 years back. And in what he tried to bring out, the study of more than 156 or 60 constitutions of the different Greek city-states, and try to formulate the best possible options for the people of the Greeks. And he tried to formulate the two different states on the basis of number of peoples who govern, and the second typology was what kind of regime it is. On the basis of that, he divided six set of system, and he started with monarchy, and its worst form of monarchy was tyranny. And then he analyzed aristocracy, and the perverted form of aristocracy was oligarchy. And the third, he declared and opined polity, and the bad form of polity was a democracy. This set of systems which compare the different kind of political system of that state, and today, more or less, it remains relevant. From the journey of 2000, almost 500 years back, it has traveled from Machiavelli, Hobbes, Locke, Montesquieu, Gabriel Amund, in which the civic culture, the book, which is a very prominent book, to P. Huntington, Third Wave, and Class of Civilizations, which all analyze a different set of political structure and systems which exist in the world and which crisscross each other, which compare each other and try to identify what are the similarities and what are the dissimilarities between the two set of systems. Moreover, after the beginning of the Cold War, as we know, a trend of democratization started in the third world countries, in Africa, Latin America, and Asia during the 50s and 60s. It became a challenge for a political scientist to identify why some of the countries were converted into a successful democratic political system, whereas the same set of system got derailed, failed. Take the example, it is very easy to identify in Pakistan and India. Both became independent on the same time. But from 1947 to 2014, you can identify how many military regimes was established in Pakistan and many other countries. Whereas India, more or less with its maybe snail space, democracy remain intact. Democracy remain not only intact but growing as well. The democracy of 1947 to till 2014, if you identify the growth of democratic sentiments and culture in India, it has definitely traveled a long way. So two neighbors which became independent and established their own political set of systems, one was successful, another was unsuccessful. In the same way, many political theorists are trying to identify from 60s to 70s, only two countries were more or less called, they are on the right track of democracy, like India and Sri Lanka. But rest of the South Asian countries were lagging behind in terms of democracy. But after 90s, if you try to keep a track, you will find that there is a momentum, there is a spirit of democracy which is unfolding not only in Sri Lanka and India, but almost all the South Asian countries, not only in South Asian countries, but Southeast Asian country as well, which were more or less moribund, which were stalled so far as the democracy was concerned. The democracy is one of the factors on which we try to compare within the political system. That is how we study the comparative politics.
This is how we study the comparative politics. But my question here is, when you talk about through this comparative politics, we try to learn the politics of the other countries. So this comparative politics, if we talk about, does it helps us in building our own strategies, how to deal with the our neighboring country or the other country of the world?
Definitely. Things are gradually changing. Things are gradually changing, and we need to keep a pace with that. If you see in the last few years, the methodology of comparative politics in 1950s and 60s or before that was institutional. If you take out a book of comparative politics or political science which was taught in colleges and universities, you can identify that there was a comparison between the institutions, like which is the more powerful, American president or Indian president? Compare the lower house of India and the lower house of Britain. This kind of comparison and most of the questions which were coming in the graduation level and post-graduation level were the comparison of the institution of the two countries. As the political science unfolded and expanded its structure, it was found that merely comparison of institutions is not enough. It is not nipping or it is not suiting the heart of political science. A number of things remain untold, number of things remain unanswered. So that is how it moved from institution to a pressure group, interest group, which evolves a different disciplines altogether. And that is how interdisciplinary approach become important component of a political theory, and that is a comparative politics. Like the study, if you want to have a complete grip of understanding of comparative politics, we need to learn political economy. The kind of economic crisis which prevailed in the Middle East, and it also affected European countries as well as America almost a year back. In 1929, the economic crisis which prevailed in America, which started a New Deal policy. In 70s and 80s, the East Asian countries, which were called the tiger economy, was under serious pressure. If we want to have a complete knowledge about it, and if you do not know the political economy, then we fail to understand the comparative politics or political science. In the same way, political geography. If you are trying to formulate a foreign policy or trying to understand the dynamics of Afghanistan, take the example of Afghanistan, where the US is going to withdraw its troops in 2014, and it will set a new set of systems and challenge before the world. Unless until the person who is supposed to be expert on Afghanistan, and if he does not know the topology, geographical locations of Afghanistan, he may not be able to describe, understand, and convince the other people. As a student of political science, we may not be aware of, if you do not know the geography, we cannot understand the topology and the politics of Afghanistan. That is how the mingling, the interaction of the different disciplines in together becomes very important. And as we study, and this is a scientific method as well, that unless we know to we try to dig the political sociology, psychology, political economy, and other different disciplines, like science also, pure science also have come under the periphery of a political science. Like, take the example of sustainable development. Take the example of climate changes, which have become the prominent part of political science in the recent decades. The conferences which are taking place, and which is determining the international politics and foreign policy, these are the themes which have become very important. And unless until we know a little bit of a pure science, we cannot understand the problem of ozone layer. And that is how the comparative politics has become very relevant, and knowledge creating, knowledge sharing for the student of political science.
Very well said, sir. In this way, you are trying to tell that we need to understand every whole or as a whole of the other part of the country, that is the other countries. Only then we will be realizing what is the comparative politics is, that is the what is the politics of that particular country. Are there other major factors also through which we can understand, like you have talked about the geography, economics? Are there other factors also through which we can understand the politics of that particular country?
As I told you, the earlier method of understanding the political science was a normative approach. And what is a normative approach is about, it is based on the value system. Like if I could say the first Prime Minister of Jawaharlal Nehru was a very eminent scholar and great administrator. That is a normative statement, that is a value-based statement. It does not verify the greatness as a ruler, as an administrator, as a prime minister of India. It could be only verified if we explain the kind of decision he has taken as the prime minister of India, and that has benefited in terms of policy to the larger section of the society of India. We can could also verify in comparing his regimes, the development of the people of India, when we compare with the other sets of regimes in India as well as other parts of the country, like the any British Prime Minister or American President. So then we can verify through the data, okay, this Prime Minister has done much more than the others, and that is why he could be called as a great administrator, great Prime Minister. Then it only becomes relevant. So normative approach over a period of time as the political science, earlier you used to call politics. Politics is a different, political studies is a different. Now when we call it a political science, an element of truth which could be verified, observed. What is a science in layman understanding, which we can observe, touch, watch and hear, which is absolutely true, like 2 + 2 = 4. It cannot be 5 at any point of time. Likewise, the political science, the understanding of political science through observations, through data, became more important and scientific, and it can only be done through observations, through the case studies, and that is how the research in political science is now based on the survey, case studies and others. We cannot say America is more powerful, or Africa is less backward, or India is more developed. We can only say through the data. These are the data which analyze the fact that in over a period of time since 1991, with the implementation of the new economic policy, Indian economy has risen. Indian economy has become more stable, more powerful, and that is how India has become one of the power centers of the world. We can only say through the data when that could be verified. When my statement could be judged through a certain tools by other, then it becomes reasonable, it becomes scientific, it becomes more argumentative and effective. And that is how we study the comparative politics.
Yes, sir, as you have well said and talked about how the comparative analysis works. But do you feel like in 1978, when non-aligned agency pool was created, and after that many agencies were formed, and in this way the intermingling of the different countries took place. This intermingling helps a lot in knowing the politics. Does it help in comparing the politics?
After the end of the Cold War, this is another important component of the comparative politics, and it is a very recent development. If you study the foreign policy of India, one of the major questions which are being raised by Indian intellectuals, which is very recent development of the development of the last one decade, very eminent teachers of India, those who are either teaching in best universities of India or they are teaching in the foreign countries, they started putting this fact across that so far we have been trying to understand the Indian foreign policy or the foreign policy, our international politics, international relations, through the prism or through the writings of the West, what the US understands, we are only talking about that. This could be the one perspective. This is not the holistic perspective. As since international politics is a late riser of political science, and most of the research, fortunately or unfortunately, it is so far the epicenter of political science, or the sister of disciplines of political science, are groomed, evolved, and developed in America and its allies in European countries, and that is how the understanding of political science is only looked through the eyes of the West. And that also becomes important when we try to analyze the foreign policy of India, our foreign policy, our theory of international politics. We also look through the eyes of the West and America. But the last one decade, many intellectuals, they developed the stimulating argument that no, if you try to understand India-China backlash, if you try to understand the dynamics of the Indian Ocean, if you try to understand the dynamics of South Asia, we need to understand through the eyes of South Asia, we need to understand through the eyes of India, we need to understand through the eyes of China, which is more important than understanding this dynamic through the eyes of West. So these are the recent developments which has come up because of the comparative analysis. The scientific methods which are being used in our political science, and that is how it becomes very, very important for all of us to grab the development of the political science, and through which this comparative politics is evolving very fast.
This is how you explained the comparative analysis used in understanding the politics of the other country and knowing how far they are going and how far we can go. But now my concern is, can comparative analysis can be used within our own country to know the politics of our own country, how far our country has moved from the year we have got independence?
Yeah, definitely. The comparative understanding of a society, a political society, could be also analyzed internally. Like if you could see the unfolding of Anna Hazare movement, and which was converted, the movement, first time in history of India, a social movement, a pressure group, was very successfully converted into a political movement, and political movement which successfully gained the power, got the power, and Aam Aadmi Party formulated its own government through the process, through the process of democratic elections, which took place a couple of months back, and from the government in Delhi. The comparison was being, could be always made. Arvind Kejriwal, the ex-chief minister of Delhi, he's compared his movement, or in fact the larger movement of Anna Hazare, was compared with the movement of JP of 1975. Somebody compares the approach of Anna Hazare as well as the Aam Aadmi Party ideology with the Gandhi, whether it is a Gandhian or non-Gandhian, what are the strategy which adopted. So comparison could be made to analyze and try to come to the truth, and which is very important. Comparison creates knowledge. It analyzes critically the theory and practice either of the Anna Hazare movement or JP movement. There are many research has been done on the JP movement, which started initially in Karnataka and Bihar and took almost the complete country by 1975. It evolves students as well as intellectuals in its own fold. But after, once the movement was successful to a certain extent, then also turned to be a fiasco, the research has been done on the movement, and many people realize and come out with the truth that it has damaged more to the society than benefited it. And why it challenged the system? It could be my personal opinion, but there are many research which explain that if you want to challenge a particular set of system and you do not put forward a very strong and concrete alternative of that political system, then anarchy could prevail. And that is same set of system when Aam Aadmi Party was in power, and while remaining as a chief minister, he demonstrated a different kind of a typology of movement which was unique in itself, and declared himself an anarchist. Now the political scientist started writing articles once he said that. Is it a good for democracy in India? A chief minister could declare himself an anarchist which can challenge the system within which he is living itself, himself. Ki system mein rehte huye, kya hum system ko, yani vyavastha ko, todne ki baat karenge? Aur todne ki baat karenge, to kya uska koi vaikalpik vyavastha banaye bina, हम ऐसी बातें करें जो लोकतंत्र का मूल मंत्र है, लोकतंत्र जिस पर टिका हुआ है, क्या उसको चुनौती दी जा सकती है? तो ये सारे प्रश्न का अध्ययन राजनीति विज्ञान के तहत होना अत्यंत आवश्यक है. और वो चीजें हम अपने विदिन सेट ऑफ सिस्टम, भारत के भीतर कई ऐसे सोशल मूवमेंट्स चल रहे हैं जो बाद में चलकर कभी कभी वो पॉलिटिकल मूवमेंट के रूप में भी कन्वर्ट हो जाते हैं. जैसे किसानों का आंदोलन स्वर्गीय टिकैत के द्वारा चलाया गया, जो वेस्टर्न यूपी और हरियाणा के कई जगहों को लेकर उन्होंने एक बहुत ही सशक्त मूवमेंट चलाया और वो बाद में पॉलिटिकल पॉइंट के रूप में कन्वर्ट हुआ. उसी तरीके से कई ट्राइबल इलाके में मूवमेंट चलाए जा रहे हैं और वो टैक्टिस, वो इंटरेस्ट ग्रुप और प्रेशर ग्रुप के रूप में काम करते हैं. तो उन सारे मूवमेंट का एक समुच्चय अध्ययन राजनीति विज्ञान में जरूरी है, क्योंकि ये मूवमेंट केवल भारत में नहीं बल्कि दुनिया के कई अन्य देशों में हो रहे हैं. ग्रीन पार्टी यूरोपियन कंट्रीज में काफ़ी सशक्त रही है, एक प्रेशर ग्रुप के रूप में रही है, बाद में पोलिटिकल पावर के रूप में वो कन्वर्ट हुआ. तो हम अपने देश के बीच के सिस्टम को दूसरे देश के सिस्टम से कंपेयर करते हैं कि वहाँ पर क्या चीज़ें थीं जो यहाँ पर हैं. उदाहरण के लिए जैसे लोकपाल बिल पर इतना विवाद हुआ, तो लोकपाल बिल की बुनियाद कहाँ से आई? ये स्कैंडिनेवियन कंट्री से आई, डेनमार्क, स्वीडन और बाकी नॉर्वे, इन जगहों से हमने ये लाने की कोशिश की कि गवर्नेंस को कैसे दुरुस्त किया जाए. हमारे यहाँ पर जो आज़ादी के बाद से लोकतांत्रिक व्यवस्था बनाए जाने के बाद एक जो राजनीतिक पृष्ठभूमि बनी, वो ऑलमोस्ट 65 सालों की यात्रा के बाद ये पाया गया कि ये पूर्णतः सफल नहीं रहा. इसमें कई कमियां हैं और कई अमेरिकन साइंटिस्ट, पॉलिटिकल साइंटिस्ट ने, लेखक ने कहा कि हमारे यहाँ पर इलिबरल डेमोक्रेसी उत्पन्न हो रहा है, गैर उदारवादी लोकतंत्र की परंपरा जो लैटिन अमेरिका के कुछ देशों में और साउथ ईस्ट एशिया के कुछ देशों में पनप रही थी, उसी तरह की व्यवस्था हमारे यहाँ पर भी है. यानी लोकतंत्र महज कुछ लोगों के हाथों में खिलौना बनकर रह गया है. तो दैट इज हाउ दिस कंपैरिजन ऑफ पॉलिटिक्स ऑफ द डिफरेंट इंस्टीट्यूशंस ऑफ इंटरेस्ट ग्रुप, प्रेशर ग्रुप्स एंड लीडरशिप become very important for the student of political science to analyze. Then we can only gain through by understanding the real meaning of a political science.
Through this comparative analysis, sir, is it possible to make speculations? We have seen many a times that before coming of a government or forming of any party, there are speculations that this government is going to be for this period. ये इतने अंतराल तक रहेगी या इतने इतने टाइम बाद ये ध्वस्त हो जाएगी. Do comparative analysis helps us to make speculations?
बिल्कुल comparative analysis, अब जैसे भारतीय परंपरा को ही देख ले, 1988 के से लेकर उससे थोड़ा सा और पहले भी चले जाएं, दो तीन साल पहले से लेकर 91 तक, what was the trend? It was declared that coalition politics in India is the day. Now it became a very integral part, and it became integral part with that so that none of the political party was in position to form the government on its own. Either it was a Congress party or its main opposition party, Bharatiya Janata Party and its allies. None of the political party were in a position to form a government of its own. So what they started doing, they started establishing its term with regional political parties. तो एक coalition politics की मिली-जुली सरकार की परंपरा हमारे यहाँ पर शुरू हुई. ये परंपरा शुरुआती दौर में बहुत ही कमजोर और विभिन्न बीमारियों की शिकार बनी रही, और हमने देखा कि 3 वर्षों के कार्यकाल में ही कई बार सरकारें गिरी और नई बनी, चाहे वो देवगौड़ा की सरकार हो, चाहे गुजराल की सरकार हो, चाहे 3 महीने की चंद्रशेखर की सरकार हो, बीपी सिंह की सरकार हो. तो कई ऐसे एक्सपेरिमेंट हुए, और हम सभी जानते हैं कि एक गरीब देश में बार बार इलेक्शन का होना, और क्योंकि इलेक्शन के साथ साथ पूरी की पूरी व्यवस्था, गवर्नेंस सेट ऑफ सिस्टम्स रिमेन स्टॉल्ड, इट डज नॉट मूव. आपके स्कूल नहीं बनेंगे, कॉलेजेस जो स्टेट का एक काम है, जो एक राज्य की महत्वपूर्ण पृष्ठभूमि है, जो मुख्य कार्य हैं, वो ठप पड़ जाते हैं, रुक जाते हैं, और सारा कंसंट्रेशन अटेंशन उस चुनाव पर लग जाता है. तो क्या एक गरीब देश में बार बार चुनाव कराना ज़रूरी है? तो उस दौरान कई तरह के फॉर्मुलेशन हमारे सामने आए कि हमें अब ज़रूरत है पार्लियामेंट्री सेट ऑफ सिस्टम से बदलकर प्रेसिडेंशियल फॉर्म ऑफ सेट ऑफ सिस्टम में जाने की. मेनी पीपल टॉक्ड अबाउट इट कि नाउ द पार्लियामेंट्री सेट ऑफ सिस्टम इज फेलिंग, व्हाई डोंट वी अडॉप्ट प्रेसिडेंशियल सेट ऑफ सिस्टम व्हिच इज prominent and prevalent in America and some of the Latin American countries, where the president is more powerful, and once the president is declared, he will remain president for 5 years despite the dissolutions of the parliament. मिली जुली परंपरा की भी बात की गई, जो जर्मनी और फ्रांस और बाकी कई जगहों पर हैं, कि प्रेसिडेंशियल और पार्लियामेंट्री फॉर्म के बीच का रास्ता समुच्चय बनाकर निकाला जाए. लेकिन इन तमाम जद्दोजहद के बीच में हमारे संविधान के जानकार विशेषज्ञ ने कहा कि नहीं, पार्लियामेंट्री फॉर्म ऑफ गवर्नमेंट में कोई ऐसी बुराई नहीं है, और ऐसे देश में जहां पर विभिन्न जाति धर्म भाषा के लोग रहते हों, वहां पर ये व्यवस्था ज़्यादा उपयोगी है, और हमारे संविधान निर्माताओं ने बहुत ही सोच विचार कर इसे अपनाया था. तो उन तमाम चीज़ों को फिर से ये नज़रअंदाज किया गया, और ये माना गया कि नहीं, हमारा जो संसदीय शासन व्यवस्था है वो निश्चित रूप से बेहतर है, और उसे आगे बढ़ाने की बात फिर से कही गई. तो हम अपने देश के भीतर के संविधान की विसंगतियों को जो उभर कर सामने आई, उस पर भी विवेचना हुई. एक समिति बनाई गई थी कि क्या हमारा संविधान whether we have failed the constitution or constitution has failed the nations. That was a committee has been constituted of eminent scholars and people. उन्होंने जब अपनी रिपोर्ट जब वाजपेयी जी प्रधानमंत्री थे उसके दौरान दी तो उन्होंने यही कहा कि नहीं नहीं हमारे संविधान में किसी तरह की कोई बीमारी नहीं है. केवल गलती अगर हुई है तो संविधान के कार्यपालन में गलती हुई है, यानी कार्यपालिका के तरफ से कहीं ना कहीं पर उनके उनके तौर तरीके में दोष है, न कि हमारे संविधान में दोष है. तो संविधान की बदलने की कोई ज़रूरत नहीं है. जैसा कि फ्रांस में करीब 10 सालों में कई संविधान बदले गए, लैटिन अमेरिका और बाकी कई देशों में संविधान बदले गए, पाकिस्तान में कई बार संविधान बदले गए, नेपाल में आप पिछले एक दशक से देख रहे हैं कि संविधान बनाने की परंपरा अभी चल रही है और अभी तक नहीं बन पाई है. तो हमारा संविधान बिल्कुल दुरुस्त है, उसमें किसी तरह की कोई परिवर्तन चूँकि उस परिवर्तन वो स्वाभाविक रूप से अपने आप में नए चेंजेस को आत्मसात करते रहता है. इट ऑलवेज एब्जॉर्ब्स चेंजेस व्हिच टेक प्लेस. तो इन सारी चीज़ों के बयानात, इन सारी चीज़ों की व्याख्या कर कर हम अपने इस न केवल देश को बल्कि पॉलिटिकल सेट ऑफ सिस्टम को और दुरुस्त और मजबूत बना सकते हैं. लेकिन हम वो तभी बना सकते हैं जब हम इसी तरह की व्यवस्था दूसरे देशों में पढ़ेंगे, समझेंगे. जैसे नक्सल मूवमेंट, माओइस्ट मूवमेंट विच इज़ वन ऑफ द मूवमेंट विच इज़ रेजिंग डिसक्वाइट इन ऑलमोस्ट 18 स्टेट्स ऑफ इंडिया. सेम काइंड ऑफ मूवमेंट also rips through the Nepal in a different mode, but it also exists in many other countries. प्रश्न उठता है गरीबी तो बांग्लादेश में भी है, वहां पर माओइस्ट मूवमेंट क्यों नहीं आया? गरीबी तो पाकिस्तान में भी है, वहां पर माओइस्ट मूवमेंट क्यों नहीं आया? गरीबी तो अफगानिस्तान में भी है, वहां पर माओइस्ट मूवमेंट क्यों नहीं आया? तो ये इन सारे सवालों का बयानात, इन सारे सवालों की जानकारी एक गहन अध्ययन के द्वारा ही हो सकती है जब हम वहाँ के पॉलिटिकल ज्योग्राफी, वहाँ के पॉलिटिकल साइकोलॉजी, वहाँ के पॉलिटिकल सोशियोलॉजी को अच्छे से अध्ययन करेंगे. तब हम ये बता पाएंगे कि भारत के कुछ राज्यों में नक्सल मूवमेंट हैं और कुछ राज्यों में नक्सल मूवमेंट नहीं है. जो राज्य अत्यंत गरीब हैं, जो इलाके अत्यंत गरीब हैं, वहाँ पर भी कई हमारे देश के राज्यों में या क्षेत्रों में नक्सल मूवमेंट नहीं है. आखिर क्यों नहीं है? तो ये एक अध्ययन का विषय है. एक ये अध्ययन तभी हो पाएगा जब हम सुव्यवस्थित तरीके से उसे हम तुलनात्मक ढांचे में डालकर अध्ययन करेंगे.
जी जी. नाउ द क्वेश्चन इज, वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट द कंपैरेटिव एनालिसिस. व्हाट आर द मेजर टूल्स दैट आर यूज्ड इन कंपैरेटिव एनालिसिस ऑफ द पॉलिटिक्स?
एज आई एक्सप्लेन्ड अर्लियर दैट पॉलिटिकल साइंस इज अ साइंस ऑफ ऑब्जर्वेशंस. द बुक which I mentioned in the beginning, Aman and Vava, who has written on civic culture, they have done a survey in the different countries of the world trying to identify the political culture of different continents of the world. Unless until we understand the psychology of a leader, we cannot understand his major decision. Suppose take the example of any Indian leader who belongs to urban areas, whose education has been done in foreign countries. He has studied and remained almost of his career out of the country, and when he joins a political party which comes into power, and he is being handed over as a minister of rural development, how will he implement the rural policies when he himself is completely unaware of the rural challenges of India? Likewise, the many other policy makers is determined by their origins. If you take the example of Sri Lankan conflict, of Tamilian conflict, in 60s, two major decisions by the president of Sri Lanka, by declaring Sri Lanka as a Buddhist state from a secular state, making Sinhalese as a national language in place of the English, created a chaos in Sri Lanka, which remained challenge for that nation state. Tamil tigers ki utpatti Sri Lanka mein isi karanvas se hui ki jab logon ka astitva khatre mein nazar aane laga, to ye nirnay kisi ek vyakti vishesh ke dwara kiya gaya. To yahan par ye samajhna mahatvapurna hai ki jo vyakti satta mein hai, jo political party satta mein hai, jo leader satta mein hai, hum jab tak uske background kis परिस्थिति में, किस जगह से, किस जाति से, किस धर्म से, उस किस किन विचारों से वो प्रभावित है, तब तक अगर हम नहीं जानते हैं तो उस देश की राजनीति को या उसकी नीतियों को समझने में हम सफल नहीं हो पाएंगे. ये एक छोटा सा नमूना, मतलब एक एग्जाम्पल हो सकता है, उदाहरण हो सकता है. उसी तरीके से दुनिया के तमाम नेताओं, जो नेता हैं, जो पोलिटिकल पार्टी है, अब अमेरिका के डेमोक्रेटिक पार्टी और रिपब्लिकन पार्टी दो महत्वपूर्ण पार्टियां हैं जहां पर चुनावी जंग में मौजूद रहते हैं. दोनों में बहुत ज़्यादा अंतर नहीं है, लेकिन नहीं होने के बावजूद भी एक बेसिक अंतर आपको दिखाई देगा कि किस कौन सा पार्टी किस कम्युनिटी को रिप्रेजेंट करता है. वहाँ पर धर्म के आधार पर प्रोटेस्टेंट और कैथोलिक हैं, कौन सा पार्टी कैथोलिक इंटरेस्ट को प्रमोट करता है, कौन सा पार्टी प्रोटेस्टेंट कम्युनिटी को प्रमोट करता है. तो उन सारी चीजों का अध्ययन उस व्यक्ति विशेष, उस राजनीतिक व्यवस्था के पॉलिसीज, उसके सोच और विचार, उसकी पृष्ठभूमि को जानकर ही हो सकता है. तभी हम समुच्चय रूप में, होलिस्टिक अंडरस्टैंडिंग ऑफ अ पॉलिटिकल साइंस कुड बी ओनली डन थ्रू अंडरस्टैंडिंग द डिफरेंट structure, different aspects of that political setup system. If you do not do that, then the understanding of a political science will remain a very shallow, and we cannot have a complete grip ki Africa mein kai deshon mein during the 50s and 60s some of the countries were converted into a democratic setup systems. But very soon they were troubled, and their set of democratic set of systems were toppled, and authoritarian and dictatorship came into power. It started unending cleanse of ethnic violence. आज भी आप खबरों में आदमी पढ़ते रहता है कि हुत्सु तुत्सी युगांडा और उसके अगल बगल के क्षेत्रों में बड़े पैमाने पर कत्लेआम हो रहे हैं. और वो कहा जाता है कि द्वितीय विश्व युद्ध में जितने लोग मारे नहीं गए थे, उससे ज़्यादा इस इतनी कॉन्फ्लिक्ट में लोग मारे जाते हैं. तो ये दोनों जाति के बीच में मुख्य अंतर क्या है? जो जिस पार्टी की सरकार बनती है वो दूसरे एथनिक ग्रुप के लिए वो एक तरह से दुश्मन की तरह, दुश्मन की नजरिए से देखने लगते हैं। आप साउथ अफ्रीका का एग्जाम्पल ले लें, नेशनल मंडेला के काल में एपार्थेड का खात्मा हुआ 1890s, वहाँ पर अंग्रेजी शासन व्यवस्था खत्म हुई, ब्लैक का शासन आया, उसके बावजूद भी लोगों के बीच में गरीबी तकरीबन 10-24 साल हो गए वहाँ पर एपार्थेड खत्म हुए हुए, लेकिन आज भी अगर सर्वे जो किया जाता है, पॉलिटिकल फ्रीडम तो मिला साउथ अफ्रीका में, लेकिन लोगों के गरीबी में बुनियादी बदलाव नहीं आए। पूछा गया कारण क्या है, तो कारण जब रिसर्च किए गए, विभिन्न तत्वों का अध्ययन किया गया, तो दे केम टू नो दैट स्टिल द इकोनॉमी इज बीइंग कंट्रोल्ड बाय द वाइट पीपल। मोर देन 80% लैंड्स आर स्टिल बीइंग कंट्रोल्ड बाय द 10% और लेस देन 10% ऑफ द पीपल ऑफ वाइट पीपल ऑफ साउथ अफ्रीका, एंड रिमेन 80% और मोर देन 80% पीपल हैव ओनली 10% लैंड लेफ्ट, एंड दैट इज हाउ द पॉवर्टी हैज नॉट बीन डिमिनिश्ड, पॉवर्टी हैज नॉट बीन कट डाउन। लाइकवाइज हम विभिन्न देशों के राजनीतिक व्यवस्था का अध्ययन जब होलिस्टिक टर्म्स में करना चाहते हैं, तो इन सारे तत्वों का अध्ययन जरूरी होगा, तभी हम एक मुकाम पर आकर ये कह सकते हैं कि ये सेट ऑफ सिस्टम महत्वपूर्ण है। पी हंटिंगटन की थियरी या टोकियावेली डेमोक्रेसी इन अमेरिका जैसे महत्वपूर्ण रचनाओं को अगर आप पढ़ेंगे, और कई महत्वपूर्ण किताबें जो कंपैरेटिव रूप में लिखी गई, वो इस बात का बयान करती हैं कि कम्युनिज्म जैसे मास मूवमेंट की बात डेविड मूर ने कही कि वो कम्युनिज्म जो गरीबी के कारण से पैदा एक मास मूवमेंट के रूप में हुआ, और मास मूवमेंट के रूप में तब्दील होने के बाद वो ऑथोरिटेरियन सेट ऑफ सिस्टम की ओर गया, क्योंकि जो मूवमेंट, जैसे कि वो चीज़ें भारत में भी हो सकती दिखाई दे रही हैं, अगर कई लोगों ने आम आदमी पार्टी को रेडिकल लेफ्ट से जोड़कर भी बयान करनी शुरू कर दी है, क्योंकि उसमें कई ऐसे लोग शामिल हो रहे हैं जो लेफ्ट ओरिएंटेशन से जुड़े हुए थे, तो मास मूवमेंट जो सिटी मूवमेंट के रूप में जो जिनका अर्बन रिप्रेजेंटेशन है वो एक इमर्ज किया, और वो उसको फिर ऐसे लोगों ने कैच करना शुरू कर दिया जो लेफ्ट आइडियोलॉजी से, रेडिकल पॉलिटिक्स से जुड़े हुए थे, तो हो सकता है कि बाद में ये कम्युनिज्म के रूप में कन्वर्ट कर जाए। तो ये सारी चीज़ें, इन सारी चीज़ों पर बयानात पहले से पॉलिटिकल साइंटिस्ट दे हैव डन इट, सो इट टू हैव अ प्रॉपर अंडरस्टैंडिंग ऑफ दिस मूवमेंट ऑफ इन इंडिया अबाउट द मूवमेंट विच इज टेकिंग प्लेस इन मेनी पार्ट्स ऑफ द कंट्रीज, वी कैन एनालाइज इन अ सेट ऑफ सिस्टम्स विच हैज बीन रिटन बाय द पॉलिटिकल साइंटिस्ट थ्रू ऑब्जर्वेशंस, थ्रू सर्वे एंड थ्रू अ प्रॉपर साइंटिफिक रिसर्च, तब उन चीज़ों को एक पॉलिटिकल साइंस के स्टूडेंट के रूप में समझने में हमें आसानी होती है।
It becomes easy for us to understand the various aspects of the politics, but can we say or ever it happened that comparative analysis failed to give out the concrete solution?
That is true. Yes, there is the limitations of comparative politics. Many theorists have identified that it is more or less the difference of methodology rather than substance of comparative politics. We cannot compare exactly, it cannot be a replica. What is happening in India could be happening in Pakistan or could be happening in Bangladesh, because the social structure or political structure of Bangladesh or Pakistan, or if you go a little far away, is completely different. You might have been hearing in the newspaper that when Anna Hazare movement was going on, he was being invited by leader of by the people of Pakistan, and he was equally prominent because the people have been people of Pakistan were reading, watching Anna movement in India. He was equally prominent in America and many other countries. Like Kejriwal, he also become a very prominent face. And he is being invited by people of the different countries. But to steer the same kind of movement in the different countries, despite having the same kind of problems, may not be easy. क्योंकि हम जो चीज़ें अपने घरों में बनाते हैं, खाते हैं, उसके स्पाइसेस अलग अलग होते हैं और उस स्पाइसेस से अपने हम टेस्ट बर्ड को भी डेवलप करते हैं. और जैसा कि हम जानते हैं कि हर एक व्यक्ति और समुदाय का टेस्ट बर्ड और फूड कल्चर डिफरेंट होता है. अगर हम वही चीज़ को दूसरे देश में ले जाकर उसी ढंग से बनाने की कोशिश करें तो मेनी पीपल वुड नॉट लाइक इट. और जब वो लाइक नहीं करेंगे तो वो हो सकता है कि मेथोडोलॉजी सेम हो लेकिन वो वहाँ पर सक्सेसफुल ना हो पाए. तो कॉम्पिटिटिव पॉलिटिक्स के जो डायनेमिक्स हैं, देयर आर सर्टेन लिमिटेशंस ऑफ द कॉम्पिटिटिव पॉलिटिक्स. वी कैन नॉट implement and we cannot completely copy and paste to other set of systems. It has a certain barricade, but barricade, despite being barricaded, as a learning lesson, as a tools to have a mirror ki haan ye cheez hai jo us roop mein dikhai di ja sakti hai aur hame ye पृष्ठभूमि में के रूप में समझने का मौका मिलेगा. दैट बिकम्स वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट फॉर द कॉम्पिटिटिव पॉलिटिक्स एज ए टूल्स ऑफ पॉलिटिकल साइंस.
बिल्कुल, चाहे हालात उस तरीके के ना हो जिस तरह के हमारे देश में, पॉलिटिक्स उस तरीके की ना हो जिस तरह की दूसरे देशों में, पर हो सकता है कभी ऐसे हालात हो जाएं कि उन देशों जैसी हमारी भी हालात हो जाएं और हमें उसी तरीके से अपनी पॉलिटिक्स को चलाना पड़े या हमारी पॉलिटिक्स को हमारे देश को चलाना पड़े. बट एज सो फार, हाउ कुड यू इवेल्यूएट दिस पॉलिटिक्स ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ द रोल ऑफ द मीडिया, द वे द मीडिया इज प्लेइंग इट्स रोल? डू यू थिंक इट इज हेल्पिंग इन कंपेयरिंग?
डेफिनेटली द मीडिया हैज इवॉल्व्ड इटसेल्फ from traditional media to the social networking. Now the digital divide of the world has completely obliterated and the world more or less in terms of the political scientist when he called it has converted into global village. He did not say global town, he said global village. Why? The affinity and the kind of attachment and alignment in the village is a very different from the city. We remain very emotionally attached, we are very sentimental, we care and share within the village, which does not take place in the town. So that is how this world has become a global village. The thing which takes place in America is immediately tweeted, flashed through social networking, and people start expressing their comments, and that becomes a chain reactions. The problem with the Middle East, as you have been hearing, reading and watching on TV, unfolding of the movement of in Middle East since 2011 to 2014, many authoritarian regimes have been disbanded. In the same way, social media started playing a very important role in Indian election as well. If you analyze the role of media in Indian politics from 1951, the first elections, to this election which is going to take place, where the media is going to play the maximum role. Every political party has started a media cell. Of course, it was started a few years back, but now it is more prominent. They started bringing a best brain in their media cells. Modi has its own people in the media cell. Congress party has late riser, but it is also equipping its media cell, other regional parties and all we know, the development of Aam Aadmi Party is completely driven by a media. So media has a very important role to formulate, reshape the politics of India, and once we reshape the politics of India, that becomes a very important component of understanding the competitive politics, how the media plays a role in America, how the media plays a role in the Middle East, how the media plays the role in African and Latin American countries. We try to identify their role and compare the set of systems, how best we can affect, reshape, redesign the political structures of India. The media is very important.
But sir, do you feel that instead of in context of the media, if we talk about media and its role in campaigning for the elections, if we talk about, rather than focusing on the consequences, it gives the effects in some way or the another. It is motivating the people that you should elect or select such particular person. Do you feel so?
Campaigning and the role of media means now it is a hotbed and hot cake for debate, and the recent comment by two prominent people of India, the ex-army chief and Aam Aadmi Party, also said something very bad about media, and another prominent people used a very unparliamentary language in demonizing Indian media. It might be possible, it might be, they might have a different perceptions, but media has an important role. At the same time, it is a truth as well that maximum media houses are being run by corporate houses, and almost all the corporate houses have affiliated either A political party or B political party or C political party, and their major agenda is to, since they are profit driven, whichever political party whom they are backing comes into power, so they should derive the maximum benefit, and that is how sometimes they go beyond the truth to the hype and create a kind of a falsehood during the elections, which is not true and which harms the movement of democracy, which befooled and blind the people of India from a right path to a wrong path.
That is very true, sir, because for a media channel, a source of revenue is a very important thing to run a very big channel or a media production house. But if we talk about the telecommunications department or the social marketing sector, this is also in some way or the another is promoting, or we can say it is taking an active part in moving our politics forward.
That is true. As we all know, that we cannot, when it is known as the fifth state of India, we cannot deny the fact that the importance and relevance of media. Democracy cannot move even an inch without the support of media. And media is an integral part. It creates a knowledge. It awares the people about the social and political problems. And the psyche of India, if you go to the villages take their interview, how they quote ki I have read in this newspaper, maine usme us khabar newspaper mein padha tha, as if writing in the newspaper is an authentic document for the people of the community, ki isme likha tha isliye sach hai. So this is the psyche of Indian people, so and that is how media becomes very important. Whatever they watch on the TV, it becomes a truth for the people of India, and common people of India, they go by the bite, they go by the written, printed words in the newspaper, and that shapes the mindset of the people of India. This is how we study in the political sociology. When we study the political sociology, and where the media plays a very important role in shaping the political mind of the people of this country.
We hope for the positive development of the country, and for all the viewers who are watching to us, we can only say that voting is their right, and they have a right to select the right candidate. Through this EduSet lecture of ours, I wish to thank you a lot that you have highlighted the very important aspect of the comparative analysis, how it is used in knowing the politics. Thank you so very much for being with us.